From the experience of finite sets, we moved to the infinite world. Our first example was natural numbers, and we were looking at what are other subsets of, other important subsets of real numbers, which are looking like natural numbers, at least theoretically. So among the family of all sets, getting a bijective correspondence, I mean 1-1 onto map in between functions, gives us a nice classification according to the size, or A and B are having in bijection, it means that they are looking alike set theoretically. So it divides the entire family of sets. So empty set, then finite sets generally, and the first infinite set what you have seen was natural numbers. So now we are looking at what are other subsets which are looking like n, that is getting bijection with n, then a set of natural numbers. Such sets we will term it as denumerable subsets, as well as countably infinite, that word also we can use it. So a set is formally called countable whenever either it is finite or denumerable. Now, as if it is not a countable set, that is, it is neither finite nor denumerable, then simply call that it is an uncountable situation. So let us look at the natural numbers. That was our first example, n. So n, which consists of 1, 2, 3, 4, etc., with an inbuilt order, first, second element, third element, like that. So any set which is having a 1-to-1 correspondence, see for example S, if I am having a 1-to-1 correspondence, ideally it means that I can simply write down like this, x1, x2, s3, like that. So this connection, this 1-to-1 correspondence will allow us to see, actually we can list it, enumerate it, the members of S, as like the elements of N is, we are doing it. That is what it means. Now looking at N, we are familiar with odd as well as even integers, I mean natural numbers. They are splitted into two. So look at E. I may write it is E, the set of even integers. Positive, it's a subset of natural numbers I am looking here now. So it consists of 2, 4, etc., etc. So is it having a bijective correspondence with N and E? Actually, yes. Because one can easily see that what happens. This gives a 1-1 onto map obviously. That is immediately one can say that it is going to be a denumerable set. In fact, you see that N, E is a proper subset of N, and you are going to have a bijective correspondence between them. In a finite world, it never happens. Once you have a set, a proper subset is not going to have a bijective correspondence with that. So it allows us to say what exactly are infinite sets too. So E, if you are writing like this, we know that N to E, we have an explicit bijection. Very formally speaking, you look at the natural way of writing down the elements here, it is simply 2N. That itself will give you the function. So if I'm giving F, which takes N to E, each natural number, I will simply write down 2, and that's enough to say that it is having in bijection or countably infinite, because it's a 1-to-1 as well as onto map. Very similar way one can try with odd natural numbers. These odd natural numbers, they are 1, 3, 5, etc. They are also allowing the listing, that is enough to say the thing. But an explicit formula is also very easy. Simply write down 2n minus 1 as the rule. For every n in n, you'll get 1, 2, 3, 5, etc. Exactly that enumeration will be there. So, if you are looking at n, the set of integers, sorry, set of even integers, natural numbers, as well as odd natural numbers, they are all having or keeping bijection in between, which means they are all looking alike. Now, what happens for a little bit bigger things? See, N is available with us. So what about Z? Z means set of all integers. positive as well as negative integers you are getting, it is zero also. So if you are moving from n to z, again this is a proper subset, n is a proper subset of z. Now on z, if you are writing down, you have to add one and join zero also with that. All natural numbers, all negative integers, they are all going to come in between. So now what happens for the size or the largeness, etc.? N, we are saying that it is a countably infinite set, as a denumerable set. Now what you are a little bit bigger set, a superset Z is given. That said, what can you talk about its size? Is it possible to have a one-to-one correspondence from N to Z? It's also possible. One way of looking at it is that, see, just list it. This set as, I will start like this, 0 is a neutral element, I will start like that. Then I can just list it 1, minus 2, 2, minus 2, 3, minus 3, like that. This actually gives a nice enumeration. In fact, I can attach 1 to 0. From natural numbers N, I can have this connection, this functional relationship. 2 goes to 1, 3 goes to minus 1, 4 goes to 2. If you are sitting, it's a nice task, a nice job to find out what is an explicit functional relation which takes any N to the Z. You can actually prove that this connection is 1 to 1 as well as 1 to. So even though Z is a super set for N, that's also going to have a bijective correspondence with N, which means that it is also denumerable. So while moving from N to Z, you are still at the denumerability level or countably infinite level. But this idea, whatever I have listed here, one can just use it for any two sets. See, for example, this was having a starting neutral fellow 0 and or positive as well as negative integers, and we have just inserted like this, just a listing like that. In fact, one can write it, this idea, you can work with any two sets. Suppose you have two sets, let me call it as A, which I will write it as A1, which is countably infinite, for example, like that. If I'm having another set B, which is going to be B1, B2, like that, then A union B is also going to be denumerable. The same idea, one can use it. This I can list it. In fact, how the elements can be listed? First from here, second from the corresponding B1, then again from A2, then B2. This enumeration will give us what exactly you have to do. Using the suffixes, you can define the function. So in fact, this kind of ideas one can develop. So manufacturing techniques like unions and taking cross product. So all these things one can think about. What happens for the denumerability or countability, etc. So for us, let us look at visiting Z. Even before that also one can say, we have natural numbers. So natural numbers are denumerable. So what can you think about N cross N? That's another way of manufacturing new sets out of the old. So N cross N, is it still denumerable or not? It's not finite, definitely. So what are N cross N's? N cross N's are actually ordered pairs of natural numbers. M, N's, M is also in natural numbers, N is also coming from natural numbers. That is what? Yeah. In fact, that is also going to be denumerable. You won't get anything more. That you will try to see. So N cross N is also going to be a denumerable set, a countably infinite set, which means N cross N is also looking like natural numbers, nothing more than that, or like integers, or like even natural numbers, or anything you can say like that. So how to see that? It is just you will be getting by understanding it's a well-known process usually called as a diagonal process. How to write all these things? Just try to look at the elements, then you will see. See, for example, if I am just fixing 1, 1, 1, first coordinate is 1, 1, then I can just list like that, 1, 2. I will just start all ordered pairs of N cross N starting with 1. So 1, 3, this kind of an enumeration I will look at. That is, the with the first element, 1 fixes. Second row, I may write it as 2, 1, 2, 2, 2, 3, like that. Fine. It goes on this way. Then 3, 1, 3, 2. Okay. 3, 3, like that. This goes well. It stretches down. Very fine. But what is the exact enumeration or the listing? How will you find it? Just simply giving like that, you can't just guess that it is an enumerable set. You are going to hit a bijection. So the what should be the first element? What should be the second element? See, for example, I can just say like that, 1, 1 is the first element. Then I can start with 1, 2 is the next element. So that some rule I have to give. Then I can say that 2, 1 is the element, or some rule I have to look at. So how can I explicitly write down that thing? One of the easiest way, as I mentioned, is just looking at the lattice. See, you display all these things in the Descartesian plane, this n cross n's. So it comes like this. See, just try to write down all these values. So here, if I'm just thinking that my plane was there, so if I'm looking 1, 2, 3, etc. here, so just look at these points. Starting with 1 as the first coordinate, you will mark 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 3 like that. This first column, it extends up. Similarly, with 2, you can again start 2, 1, 2, 2 like that. That will come. So I'm just displaying this thing as like this. Now, it is easy. The arrows will give you what should be the order. So first I will consider this. Then I may go for 1, 2. The second element is 1, 2, then go for 2, 1, then I will come back to 1, 3, then 2, 2, then 3, 1. This is a nice arrangement. I mean, first, second, third, fourth, like that. So I am just displaying 1, 1, 1, 2, then 2, 1, then 1, 3, like that. These arrows or diagonal process will exactly gives you a 1 to 1 correspondence with the natural numbers. So that says that n cross n is denumerable. This is not the only way. You can actually take any zigzag way also. First here, second here, third here, something like that. Doesn't matter. But it should be very specific and well defined. That's all. But this idea is highly useful in many, many places. This diagonal kind of arguments. So taking N as a denumerable set, N cross N is also denumerable, which actually gives, as I mentioned, A is denumerable, B is denumerable, A cross B is also going to be a denumerable set. Basic idea is like that. So let us look at one important aspect of this. See, once some natural number system, you have started with the first infinite set, which is going to be a countable infinite set. And if you are looking at what are other kinds of sets, we are calling, and they are going to be denumerable, right? Generally, countable set, it just means either it is finite, I mean empty set or a finite set, or it has to align with natural numbers. But to test that, one can use the following fact also. That is really useful. So that we will just look at. It is not, they can work out, and a theorem can be stated like this. The following statements are going to be equivalent. What it says is the following. S is a countable set. First one, if you are having a countable set S, obviously we know that either it is finite or it is countably infinite, then it is always true that you will get a surjection from N onto S. So from N to S, you will get a surjection. That is clear. So once it is countable, either it is finite you have to work out, or generally infinite in the level of countable infinity to work out. So one can see that even you will definitely get a surjection, and converse is also true. If you are having a surjection from N to S, you can always state that it is going to be a countable set, right? That one can see. Very similarly, if you are having an injection, that is a 1-to-1 map from S into N, that also will guarantee it is going to be a countable set. So the effect is something like that. If you want to declare that some set is a countable set, either you have to find a surjection onto map from n to that set, or an one to one map from S to N. These two things are enough. There is a good proof in Bartle, and one can follow that. But this idea, we will use it again and again. So to say something, some set is countable, either B part or C part will help us. That's again useful in determining. For, see, for example, N we have seen, N cross N we have seen, or one a little bit Z also we have seen. Even if you are looking for a bigger set, something like Q, rational, set of all rationals. The next important question is that, while moving from N to Z, we have seen denumerability is kept intact. Now Z to Q, what is the effect? That also we will visit. So what about Z? What about Q? I will denote it as Q. In fact, we will see what happens for that. So Q is also going to be a denumerable set. What does it mean? Ideally, you are going to get a 1-to-1 onto map from N to Q. But we have so many results now to make use of. So basically, somebody is asking, what are Q? They are all P by Q forms. P and Q are integers. Q not equal to 0, etc., etc. So they are termed in, decomposed into positive rationals. Let me write something like Q plus stands for positive rationals as well as negative rationals. But it is easy. Once you are proving that Q plus is a denumerable set, Q plus to Q minus, easily one can get a bijection. It's not a fact at all. Easily one can move. Now, Q plus Q minus, then what is the neutral element? 0. These all together will give me what exactly is Q. So I am asked, or we are looking at, to answer the question, is Q is denumerable? It is enough if you are proving that Q plus is denumerable, because Q plus is denumerable, Q minus also one can, because they can easily find out the bijection from here to here. Then this is denumerable, this fellow is denumerable, this is a finite set, they are all countable, all such things you can use it. So union also is going to be a denumerable set, being this fellow is denumerable. So the only crux of the matter is you have to prove that Q plus is denumerable. So what are Qs? Q plus. So the whole work is subsumed to the fact that Q plus is denumerable. So what are Q plus? Q plus are just M by N's. M and N are positive integers, you can say. So M and N are integers. N is away from 0. So one easiest way is to look at these fellows is that M and N are not fully natural numbers, even it's only positive I'm taking, M and natural numbers. So to understand this, one can also look at the following fact, how to list it. That is the only thing. So M by N forms first something like denominator is simply 1, you keep it. So I have to consider 1 by 1, 2 by 1, 3 by 1, 4 by 1, like that. All these fellows will give me with denominators as 1. Very similarly, I can work with 1 by 2, 2 by 2, 3 by 2. The sequence will form like that. 4 by 2. Then again, 1 by 3, 2 by 3, 3 by 3, 4 by 3, like that. So from here again, in downstairs also it goes on. Here also I can work the diagonal mapping. Somehow I can define this is the first fellow according to these arrows. This will work out. First, second, third, fourth, fifth, like that. So what is the advantage of this fellow? There are many ways of saying this. Ideally, we are going to look like this. So first of all, once you are getting like this, see, N you are given, but this set M by N, whenever you are trying to look at Q plus, you are working with M by N. So the hidden thing is that you are working with M N's. Both M and N are natural numbers. So any Q plus element will be of this form whenever you are seeing, you are working with an M by N. which means you have to look at n cross n's. You know what about n cross n is. So, from n cross n to q plus, you'll get SR injection easily. This is the whole idea what I'm going to use it first. Okay, let us formally write down all these things and see. So, to prove this, I'm going to depend on this diagonal thing as I mentioned before. And the rest of the things are easy. Since n cross n, I can compare this all q plus with n cross n. I'm going to get a function, a surjection f, that is the first thing what I'm going to get. I have a surjection from natural numbers to n cross n. Is it correct? Because n cross n is obviously a denumerable set that you have seen. So, by the previous result which you have done, there exists a surjection. So, there exists a surjection f from n to n cross n. Now, this kind of mapping, what it actually gives is, this display gives us a function which is also going to be a surjection from n cross n to q plus, because all q plus elements I have written like this. So, take any q plus element here, I can go back to a n cross n element, which says that again I am going to get a surjection. Through this map, what I am going to get, this display I am going to get, a surjection from n cross n to q plus. So, already n to n cross n, I have surjection because this fellow is denumerable. Now, this display allow me to give surjection. So, composition of these two maps will give a surjection. To surjective max, I will make it composition. So, what you are going to have now is nothing other than that you have a surjection from natural numbers to q plus, which ensures that q plus is countable. Right? In fact, q plus is countable and q is not finite. That is easy to see. So, you have to see get that q plus is actually going to be a denumerable set. In fact, the same size you will be getting to q minus. You can transist to q plus to q minus. Then just adjoining a zero element, it won't give anything extra, which means you are still going to be a denumerable set. So ideally, you will get the proof as q, which is q plus union zero union q minus is going to be a denumerable set. That is what we have proved. This is also a nice thing because we have seen the q. I mean, while moving from natural numbers, first we went to n cross n obviously and z, and again go for q. Q is also going to be denumerable. It actually says something more. See, if you are looking at q, you are looking at all p by q forms, p and q are integers, q away from zero. But it says that just like natural numbers, you can list them, enumerate them, first element, second element, third element, like that. That is a fantastic thing. It is very handy now. In fact, this what you have displayed here and worked with q plus will allow to say the following also. Countable union of countable set is again going to be a countable set. That also somebody can just write it as a result also. That's easy because that also is a good result because all AM, so I am having a family of countable sets. I mean, countable family of countable sets. A1 is a countable set. A2 is another countable set. A3 is another countable set. So, A1 I have to list it as a set like natural numbers. So, I can simply denote A11, A12, A13 like that. Similarly, say A2, I can fix like A21, A22 like that. Then once again, if you are using these ideas, the diagonal mapping will allow you how to say the result, how to prove the result for the unions. Because altogether, you have to get it. That is the union. So it's going to come. So that is, that can be tractable in the same manner. The diagonal process will give the answer. Because once you are having like this, immediately you can do like this kind of arrows will give the answer. Why a countable union of countable cities again going to be countable. So it's also a very useful fact. So remember these ideas. Whenever you are moving from N to Z, Z to Q, all such things, you are always getting supersets always, but still we are working with a countably infinite setup. So looking at the size, see, suppose this question is relevant then. I'm equipped with a set. Yes. How can you make a bigger? Are you sure that some large set is large in the sense of size exists if I'm just given with an S? Is such a question is answerable? Given with any set, is it possible to find you some set which is larger than, strictly larger than? Yes, this strictly larger, I have to explain, but still it is not, it's beyond that. Whatever be the size of the natural number is, whatever the size of the given set is, like that. So going for larger and larger sets, what is the usual technique? Technique is easy. Once you are, you might have been seen this in the finite world also. Suppose S is having some three elements, A1, A2, A3. If you want to make a bigger set in size than S, without looking even the elements, you just go for power set of S. You can experience it. Because this is having n elements. You know that power set of S is having 2 raised to n elements in general. So this 3 means 2 raised to 3 will come. But that idea is very, very important. Once you have S, any set S, go for the power set of S. It always takes you to a very big set than S. You wanted to say that. So that is known as Cantor's theorem. It's very profitable, very wonderful theorem. You state it. A is any given set, whatever may be the set is that. Then, if you are looking at the power set of A, all subsets of A, the family of all subsets of A, then you cannot find a surjection. It never exists a surjection. You can't find a surjection. There is no scope there. Cannot find a surjection means you cannot have this. I mean, no bijections, obviously. So it means that you are going to have a bigger and bigger things always. An ultimate universe is not going to come with that. That is the whole moral of the story. So how will you prove this? That's what you have to look at. It's a very beautiful proof, Cantor's argument. So we'll visit that also and conclude this session. Suppose on the contrary that there exists a surjection. That is phi or phi is a mapping from, am I right, phi is a mapping from A to the power set of A. Remember that on the right hand side you are having power set of A. Which takes that if you are having an element A here, phi of A, it means that this is a subset of A. Remember, this is going to be a subset of A. So phi of A is a subset of A, it means you can talk like this. This starting element assigning to phi of A, that is a set, means this question A is whether it belonging to A or A does not belong to A. These are the possibilities. Because the codomain is like that. So depending on that, we will define another set. See, let me write D. This consists of all elements of A, that is a subset of A, such that A does not belong to phi of A, because phi of A is a subset of A, because so I can either this or this. So it says that I'm going to consider a subset like this, a subset of A like this, like the, what? Those A in A for which A does not belong to phi of small a. That is my, this is my defining, the defining condition to be a member of the set D. It's going to be a subset of it. Now, we have assumed what? This is a surjection, right? It's an onto map. This is a subset of A. You are from here now. D is from here now. So, what you can say is that some member should be here. It should have a preimage. So, A0 should be mapped onto D. So, which once again, it says that there exists an A0 in A such that phi of A0 is going to be D. This is what it says. Okay, fine. This is to be true for some A0 here, for some A0 in A. Everything looks nice. Now, the problem starts. See, we have D here. D is a subset of it, right? D is a set. So, you try to talk about A0. A0 is in A. So, try to determine whether it is in D or not. How will you look that? Suppose A is in D. What does it mean? A0 satisfies defining condition. Defining condition is this, which says A0 does not belong to phi of A0. That is the defining condition. What is phi of A0? It is nothing other than the D from here. What it says now? A belongs to D. It implies, A0 belongs to D. Implies A0 does not belong to D. This is same as A0 does not belong to D. Utter contradiction. Right? On the other hand, A0 is not in D. Then what happens? Because A0 should be either in D or in, it's outside of D, complement of D. This means what? A0 is not in D means this is not satisfied, which means A0 belongs to phi of A0. But phi of A0 is D. Once again, what you are getting? A0 belongs to D. Again, starting from here, again, blunder, a contradiction. So both these things are not going to be possible. Which gives, we have started with a wrong thing. You cannot be done with a surjection. So the proof is very beautiful and it says that there exists no surjection from A to P of A. Very beautiful proof due to Cantor. So we'll just visit the set theoretical aspect like this later only, because whatever the necessary things for understanding real number system, these set theoretical notions are enough for us.